If you're using a microcontroller such as a Teensy or an ESP32 and have a graphical display, you've probably wanted to create screens for presenting things like main menus to your users. Or maybe you want to put up some type of a warning when a sensor fails to initialize. Or maybe you just want a visually appealing screen to show all of your sensors' outputs. My personal favorite is tabular type data, like car race times. But you know the drill. Creating such displays is very challenging to do. You've got to define a color, and you know, what is it? How does it look against other ones? You don't know until you've compiled, uploaded, and realized that's not it. My personal favorite is, where is the screen location? You got to type in some coordinates and just magically know where things have to go relative to each other. Will the font size fit? You don't know until you've compiled, uploaded, and realized that's not it. What if you could take a complex screen that looks like this, that's easy to build in something like PowerPoint, push one button, and get the INO code to match? This was actually code generated from my utility here that was created in PowerPoint, and with one button, it generated all the code to give that exact result. Let's take a look at how this works. Before we begin, you must be able to run PowerPoint with macros enabled. An embedded macro based on VBA is what does all the magic. The size and scale of these slides are 3 inches by 2.5 and is intended to match the aspect ratio of a 320 by 240 display. This is done intentionally to make the resulting fonts on a display match the size in the presentation. If a string or rectangle span the width of a slide, it should span the width of a 320 pixel screen. Fonts used in this presentation are Arial and map 1-to-1 with Teensy Arial fonts. Adafruit does not deliver Arial, but their Free Sans font is close. Well, kinda. See my other videos on how to create custom fonts for either the ILI9341T3 driver or the Adafruit 9341 drivers. If you've ever written automation code in Office, it's never without any unforeseen issues, as not all parameters are exposed to the API. If you encounter an issue, please open an issue on the GitHub repository and not in the comments on this YouTube video. My current project here is an irrigation system for my house, and I'd like to have some kind of a graphical display to show me where the zones are and if they're on or off. So let's begin sketching maybe the top view of my house and where these zones are. I'm going to use good old-fashioned PowerPoint, draw a picture of the house, maybe a rectangle for the top view, maybe another one for what I call the bay window room, maybe another little room off the very back of the house. And last but not least, there's a small outshoot for our garage. Let's make everything black and not have any kind of hidden lines on here. Now I've got to define where my zones are. Now this may not be anatomically correct, but you'll get the idea of where I'm going with this. We'll draw a line here, make sure I get this thing horizontal. And it's probably good enough. Copy that to the clipboard. We'll add this to the other side, maybe somewhere over here. I think I've got like two zones in the backyard. So we'll add one zone here, and it doesn't have to be anatomically correct for this demonstration here. Just an idea of how you can graphically lay things out and use this utility here to stop snapping PowerPoint. And just a couple zones in the front. Use PowerPoint to define what your graphical screen is going to look like. And maybe we want some buttons up here. So let's add a button. This is zone 1. And I think this is zone 2. I don't know. Kind of doesn't matter, really. And this is zone 3 and zone 4 and 5 and so on and so forth. I won't add the last button here, but I do want a button here for setup. So I can control times, when things go on, when they go off, and so on and so forth. And we'll make all these buttons the exact same here. So we'll just pick all of them, go into the object, and we'll go to size, and we'll just pick the height. Ooh, not that big. How about that big in the width? Something like such, just to make everything nice and neat. Of course, I'm going to make everything Arial, because that's the kind of guy I am. And I'll show you a reason why in just a few minutes. And maybe we'll make these lines here green. I didn't make that one perfectly horizontal there, but it kind of doesn't matter. I mean, it does at the end of the day. I want everything nice and horizontal and vertical. That's the whole point of this. But for this demonstration, it could be a little on the sloppy side. And we'll make these buttons here. How about a fill of maybe, oh, I don't know. Pick a color, any color. Something like such. And maybe we'll make the font black. All right. So that's it. Let's just pretend that's all I want. That's what I want my graphical screen to look like. Now, all you need to do is go to the first slide, go to presentation mode, and click the Create INO button. The user interface actually looks like this. So I can specify the display that I want. If I want to use an ILI 9341 from Adafruit, I can map fonts to the three that they deliver for free. But I'm going to use my trusty Teensy and the T3 library. You cannot create buttons. You can create buttons using the display library, which is built into these libraries up here, or my custom library, which is my personal favorite. If you want to create variables from numbers, you can do that and a variety of other things. If you want to control settings like what your object names are, I happen to call mine display, but some people like TFT, touch for touch, and so on and so forth. You can control all that as well. Then all you need to do is hit the generate INO file. Now what it's going to do, it's already ripped through and it's built some of my code for me, my INO file. Sorry, wrong one here. We'll let it rip through again and generate some more code. And I'm just simply in the debugger inside the VBA project here. And we'll generate some more code, some pin definitions, some color definitions, which are always my favorite to have to include, font definitions as well, and some basic variables. Remember how I said numbers can become a variable? Here's where I create that. I'm only creating ints and floats, so you have the choice of changing these to whatever you want a little later on. Also, I created some buttons, and I've got the button text and button object creation. And I think a few more lines here will show you things like button initialization, corners, a loop, and all of the screen code itself. Imagine trying to write this code here to get the exact screen that you just saw in the presentation there. This example that I've created earlier is a little more refined, has a cute little logo up there and some more buttons. And after running the INO code generator, here's what you get. Pretty anatomically correct. There might be a few things a little off here, but generally pretty easy to fix at this point in time. What's supported? First, our lines. Whether you're doing a thin line or a thick line, we support all of them. Keep in mind that a diagonal line is single pixel only, but if you're doing a horizontal or vertical line, you can adjust the line thickness in PowerPoint, and we'll mimic that inside of this tool. You can use any color except for special effects. I am not ripping through and getting an array of all the lines and sorting them, so we do not preserve Z order. I also support rectangles, whether they're a thick border or a thin border, filled or hollow. If you're using a one pixel border, I'm smart enough to know that this is going to be transparent so you can see things behind it. If it's a thin, we're actually going to be drawing two rectangles, one over the other, to get that thick border. So you won't have control over the actual transparency. You can make them any color that you want, but we don't support special effects, and I'm not preserving Z order. There is an option in the utility to convert a rectangle with text to an actual button object. And after running the code, here are the results. I also support round rectangles, thick border or thin border. Don't rotate them and don't flip them. That's not supported. They could be any color. However, if you do want to get a thick border that's filled, just draw two rectangles. You can also convert a round rectangle with text to a button. We also support isosceles triangles, thick border or thin border, hollow or filled. When it comes to isosceles triangles, we don't allow flipping horizontal or vertical. However, you can rotate them in increments of 90 degrees. We don't support special effects or irregular triangles like the green one at the very bottom of the screen. If you do want a thick border, just draw one triangle on top of the other. To give you an example of where you can use isosceles triangles, maybe you have some type of a controller that you're developing and you want the user to be able to enter in the height, width, or the radius of some type of a cutting parameter. Great use of these triangles. We also support right triangles, whether it's a thin border or a thick border, you have that control, hollow or filled. Keep in mind, these are very different from isosceles triangles. You don't rotate these to get a different shape. Here, you use the flip. When it comes to fonts, I support two types, some for Teensy and fonts for Adafruit ILI 9341. We support bold, italics, or both, and you can use other fonts. If you want a different font, just specify whatever font you want in your PowerPoint and change the include.h file and the defines a little later on. And I'll show you how to do that. Teensy fonts render the best on these graphical displays using this library, and my favorite part is they support 8 up to 96. Here's an example of that same screen outputted using this utility. Like I mentioned, we also support Adafruit fonts. Regardless of what your presentation includes, you have the ability to font map to their free mono, sans, or serif in 4 sizes. If you want to use a different font, you can do that. Specify whatever you want in the presentation, but change the include and the defines later on. Text support generally, any color, center justification, and variables can be generated from numbers. One of my personal favorites here. But things like margins, we don't honor. Text wrapping, line wrapping, we don't honor that. And of course, rotated text. Also, there's no support for bullets, numbering, special characters. If you do want a special character, just simply draw a very small font in a second text box. Table creation is also supported. You can specify any number of rows and columns with variable height. Text in each cell will be replicated with the appropriate font and color. Those are the supported objects, but what happens to unsupported objects like the arrow, the green star, or that do not do this symbol? The utility has an option to convert all of these to placeholders, like the red X. We do put code in the INO file letting you know that there is an unsupported object. Let's see how to change fonts using this example. So all you need to do is go into PowerPoint, change these fonts to whatever, and I'm going to change them to, Digital 7 and 10 point, because that's what I have a font for, or at least what I'm going to create a font for. And we'll do these little guys over here. Same thing, digital, pitch, 10 point. Now I've already run the utility, and when you get the INO code, you'll notice that you're going to get this funny font up in here. And down in the include, we have this as well. So now we need to generate that font. If you watch one of my other videos, you'll see this neat utility that somebody wrote to convert fonts into ILL 9341 T3 fonts. So all you need to do, launch the tool, do a new font from a file, and we'll pick our digital font, digital 7 in 10 point. And just like that, it brings in these fonts, like all of your numbers and so on and so forth. Zoom in here, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then you just simply export that to your file. And I've already done this ahead of time, so we'll just call this digital 10, I think it was. And then go back over to your defines. We'll call this digital underbar 10. And we'll change the include to digital underbar 10. And just like that, we'll generate our screen font. Of course, if I upload the code and generate the screen code, it'll look something like what you see on the screen here. Creating the code generator was the easy part. The hard part is being inspired to create really cool projects. So get to coding, and thanks for watching.